it's just like a generation is gone, and it's just amazing to think if those people were still alive, what the art world, the theater world would be like. It would be very different.
Where AIDS came from, God only knows.
I think that I've been terrorized as a gay man into believing things about HIV and AIDS that are not provable.
It was just a crazy construct in the beginning. The original definition of AIDS doesn't have any resemblance to the current definition of AIDS.
That's not an epidemic. The number of cases reported went up epidemically, you know, exponentially, because the number of tests that was done went up exponentially.
It follows a long-standing tradition of basically dumping our abandoned drugs onto the third world.
It's really society that's killing these people in general, and modern medicine that's killing them in particular.
I believe I'm alive after 20 years of being HIV positive because I didn't take AZT or any anti-AIDS drug.
As long as AZT remains on the market, we continue to be betrayed.
I think there is a severe crisis in science as a whole, and in medical sciences in particular. They don't question anything.
The entire AIDS establishment is absolutely guilty of some hideous sins, and everybody's been fooled. That's hard to believe, see? It's like, no, it can't be.
I would say we have acquired information deficiency syndrome or a scandal.
We maintain that HIV is a big mistake, possibly one of the biggest mistakes of the 20th century.
How is this virus causing AIDS? How is it causing the depletion of immune cells when you can't even find it?
Nobody has ever seen HIV. We have seen diagrams of HIV. We've seen posters, all of those with drawings of HIV. But this is only theoretical, the way that it ought to be.
When two different parties look at the same data and come to different conclusions, it's no longer scientific.
Actually, AIDS is a religion of these people. They believe in this virus.
There is so much money being pumped into AIDS that people have no incentive whatsoever to see the truth.
Maintaining this industry, maintaining this whole idea that there's this epidemic pending and that HIV causes AIDS is a major public relations process in the United States.
If a hypothesis fails to produce results, that we have to reconsider that hypothesis.
I'm in the Museum of the City of New York. There is a 20-year retrospective on AIDS. In this retrospective, if you look around, there's beautiful posters and very poignant and touching photographs and stories of people who have been afflicted with AIDS. Also, all along the walls are little charts, chronologies of events, like when AIDS was discovered, and then the test, the antibody test, that people should be tested to determine, do they have this deadly disease? That there is hope, not for a cure, but instead put time on your side, take AZT or other antiretroviral cocktails. That's the messages. I'm Gary Nall, and I'd like to open up a dialogue that allows those who've been excluded from the communication in the war on AIDS to have a forum. These individuals are sincere, they are credentialed, and they have a lot of good questions and challenging statements for those who are absolutely convinced that everything we've been taught about AIDS is right. It is the intent of this program to have a forum for the dissidents. The most responsible and reasoned of those individuals, you're now going to have an opportunity to see what their argument is as they try to deconstruct what they consider the myth of AIDS.
Professor David Rasnick, one of the developers of the protease inhibitors commonly used for persons with AIDS, came from a scientific established background. He has done extensive research on the subject of AIDS and is now one of the most outspoken AIDS dissidents.
The best evidence against the HIV hypothesis is that there is no evidence for it. In the vast scientific medical literature, over 100,000 journals published so far on HIV/AIDS, we cannot find anywhere in this vast literature the evidence that HIV causes AIDS, that AIDS is a contagious disease or that it even sexually transmitted. If this had been shown that AIDS is caused by HIV, we should know who these benefactors of humanity are by name. These would be candidates for the Nobel Prize. But I challenge you, any American, journalist, scientist, to come up with the names of these individuals who we should revere and should honor with awards and things. And I think you will find that you won't be able to come up with it.
In 1984, Luc Montagne wrote in Nature, quote, "All available data are consistent with the virus being the causative agent of AIDS," end of quote. But in 1985, he expressed an opinion which is impossible to reconcile with the HIV theory. I quote, "This syndrome occurs in a minority of infected persons who generally have in common a past history of antigenic stimulation," that means immune stimulation, "and of immune depression before HIV infection." In other words, Montagne was claiming that the cause of the immune depression was coming after the effect, which is contradictory. Perhaps Montagne was hedging his bets even at that early stage.
14 years ago, Dr. Peter Duisberg was the lone voice in the world of AIDS dissonance. At that time, the molecular biologist, world-renowned virologist, and UCLA professor began asking a question that seemed like heresy in his day. Was it possible that we were wrong when we equated HIV with AIDS?
Gallo tried in hundreds of patients to find that virus and came up with a sample that he borrowed from a French colleague. I know Gallo, and Gallo is not a bad virologist. He would have found a virus that is there at concentrations where it could cause a disease. But Gallo proved to the scientific world with this what proved to be a nearly a scandal in the scientific history. He claimed the virus from a colleague as his own. He proved that it was very, very difficult, even for an excellent laboratory as Gallo was operating it at the NIH, to isolate a virus from an AIDS patient.
There has never been viremia, which means the blood flooded with whole cell-free infectious viruses. If HIV were actually doing anything, making people sick, there would indeed be viremia, meaning millions of whole viruses per milliliter of plasma. In fact, nobody has ever observed even one of them.
HIV is so clever that it knows to cause Kaposi sarcoma in gay men. 98% of all Kaposi sarcoma is in gay men. HIV knows to cause tuberculosis and wasting in IV drug users, and it knows to cause diarrhea and candidiasis or thrush in hemophiliacs.
It's not just Peter Duisberg or some heretics or some outsiders who criticize the failure of our war against AIDS. It's the orthodoxy itself. They advertise they have not saved one single life with $60 to $80 billion. That means in conventional scientific logic, there could very well be something profoundly wrong with the basic hypothesis, with the basic approach that we use against AIDS.
Some of the most vocal critics of the HIV equals AIDS hypothesis are a group of Australian researchers led by Dr. Eleni Papadopoulos-Eliopoulos. In their breakthrough report, the scientists raised serious questions about the accuracy of HIV antibody tests, and more importantly, the very relationship of HIV to AIDS. In fact, in their newest work, they are questioning, has HIV even been isolated?
As far as we are concerned, if one goes through all the HIV literature which exists to date, I think one will find it bold and incredible to still believe that there is proof for the existence of HIV. When a particle looks like a retrovirus, you have to isolate it, then put it in another culture, show that the cells in the secondary culture produce particle exactly like the particles from which they originated. But the two particles from the two cultures are exactly the same can be shown only by determining their constituent proteins in RNA. So isolation is extremely important to prove that a particle is a retrovirus.
From the mid-70s until 1984, when the so-called official cause of AIDS was found, it was shown that many individuals within the gay community were suffering from a unique form of gay men's disease. The original theory was that AIDS was caused by a lifestyle.
It was in June 81 when the first publication came out, published by the Centers of Disease Control, saying five men had PCP and two of them died even being treated with Septrim, this last or the strongest antibioticum available.
AIDS was first identified among gay men in 1981 who practiced certain lifestyle behaviors. They, according to the New York Times, on July 3rd, 1981, tended to have upwards of 2,000 sexual contacts a year and used a lot of aphrodisiacal drugs, including poppers, amyl nitrite, a very dangerous substance that gay men had been inhaling in epidemic proportions since the early 1970s. And with regard to the sexual activity, you don't need to be moralistic to say that, you know, gosh, you have 2,000 sex partners a year, you develop a laundry list of infectious diseases, venereal diseases, that can do a lot of damage over the long term to your immune system. Doctors and scientists looking at this phenomenon early on said, gosh, they do a lot of drugs, they have a laundry list of venereal diseases. The combination of these factors might well be enough to knock their immune systems for a real loop.
They took tons of antibiotics to treat the perpetual infections they would get by having a lot of different sex partners. And between the drugs and the infections and the antibiotics and the treatments, plus just partying all the time and being very run down, it's really a wonder that they didn't get sick sooner.
One of the leading critics of the war on AIDS is Professor Stefan Lanka, a German biologist and virologist who questions the isolation of HIV and many contradictions and lack of proper scientific reasoning behind the HIV theory, including the wrong form of treatment for a person with AIDS.
The background of AIDS, and we are absolutely sure about this, is the antibiotic resistance catastrophe, killing people in hospitals like flies, because there are no antibiotics available without resistance in some bacteria. So in a state of immune suppression in the hospital, a lot of people come down with bacterial infections. This is called sepsis because of blood poisoning. When too much bacteria are growing and producing toxins, this is going to kill them in a state of reduced immunity. And we had these problems already in the beginning of the 70s. There have been kind of emergency conferences dealing with the problem because they were scared that resistance would spread and they have no antibiotica available. So they invented a very strong antibioticum, and it's not an antibioticum to say, it's pure chemotherapy. It's a double folic acid antagonist. The good old sulfonamide and two of them put together would kill every microbe. But the problem is they were scared that in the gay scene new resistance would develop and spread into the population.
I mean, before 1984, when it was announced that HIV was the cause of AIDS or the probable cause of AIDS, it was sort of more of a level playing field in a sense, because viral causation hadn't been proved and, you know, scientists and clinicians were looking at more of a multifactorial model, maybe an environmental model or even a toxicological model to explain the phenomena of AIDS.
Many of the early AIDS cases were very, very sick. They were close to death when they got their diagnosis. Some of them had Kaposi sarcoma, which is a poorly understood affliction of the blood vessels. At the time, they thought it was a cancer. Now it's known it's not. But they were given aggressive forms of chemotherapy, which had the result of killing virtually all of them. The doctors later realized it was a mistake, only to the extent they stopped it, although the medical profession never quite admits they've made a mistake.
The AIDS definition was there before, saying if you have PCP and if you have KS, caused by nitrites as well, because the nitrites are transformed into NO only in the smallest vessels, because the partial pressure of oxygen is high enough to perform this transformation, and NO is a very potent growth stimulant. So we have this neoplasia and hyperplasia in the endothelia, and this condition is called a Kaposi sarcoma.
It was on April 23, 1984, that Margaret Heckler announced to the world that the cause of AIDS had been found, namely HIV. Dr. Robert Gallo's colleagues said that his research made possible a blood test for AIDS and that a vaccine would be ready for testing in 2 or 3 years. That was in 1984.
AIDS started partly when they said that it's possible to measure the strength of the immune system analyzing or counting T4 cells, the so-to-say helper cells. But that's not possible. And it has already been published in 81 in the journal JAMA, Journal of the American Medical Association, saying that it makes no sense to count subsets even of lymphocytes, because there was never a correlation. It could be high or low, and people are healthy or ill, it doesn't matter. So this was already known. But the problem was at this time already that in medicine people would not look to the facts, but what is possible to sell on the market, because it was the year 1977 when it became possible to patent medical techniques. So they wouldn't care if there's any a clinical meaning behind those measurements, but they just sold it on the market. And the model of immunology would say at this time, if the immune system is weak, so cancer would appear. And that has been fundamentally mistaken, and it was wrong when they said it in 81. They knew it already in 1980 that this has been wrong. The immune surveillance theory of cancer came into existence when the war against cancer failed.
About 1970, major cancer research laboratories were passionately involved in attempts to demonstrate that retroviruses were associated with human cancer. They really didn't get very far, not far at all. And somehow, around 1980, 81, when the first cases of AIDS were reported, this came to these groups as at least one way out of the mostly negative result they had obtained for about 10 years before. So the AIDS research, I regard it as an extension of an earlier effort to demonstrate retrovirus in human cancer.
They were working with the test, with cells in the test tube, and say, look, we have a high activity of reverse transcription, therefore a virus must be inside, and the virus is the cause of cancer. But the nature of cancer is much different, and when they found reverse transcription everywhere, they gave up the idea that retroviruses would cause cancer. And they were not speaking about it anymore, but wasted billions of dollars into this and developed chemotherapy based on this idea that the multiplication of genetic material, and they were thinking of the viruses, should be blocked. So they developed molecules which were incorporated in a growing chain of newly to build up genetic material, and which would kill the build up or prevent the build up of this genetic molecule, and the cell eventually has to die. The idea of retroviruses in cancer is long over, but the chemotherapy still is there because it's sold, and they have no idea why, no rational explanation why they are using chemotherapy.
In 1984, Robert Gallo comes along, gives a press conference and says, hey, all of these diseases are caused by a virus. Here's his theory. HIV kills T cells, decimates the T cell population, causing acquired immune deficiency, which is opens the gateway to infection with any number of opportunistic infections, 30 at this point.
This is what we call the syndrome of AIDS-defining diseases. Problem is, if all these diseases among these populations were caused by a virus, one would think that these, you know, this constellation of diseases, this syndrome, would spread from the original risk populations into the general population. That's what infectious diseases do. They spread out of, you know, the original risk populations. Problem is, through 1992, this simply wasn't the case. After 10 years of this so-called raging AIDS epidemic, over 90% of AIDS patients cumulatively remained within those original risk groups. And of those remaining 10%, you have to consider that those included all homosexuals who didn't care to admit their sexuality to their doctor, all IV drug users who didn't care to admit their drug habits to their doctor, and all infants AIDS patients. So you've got a disease that's really restricted to certain risk populations, and it's not spreading. Hence, it's terribly unlikely that this disease could be caused by a virus.
In science, certain rules must be followed for any agent to be considered a causative factor in disease. The first rule is that an agent that is going to be blamed for a disease should be able to be isolated from each and every case of the disease. That is not true in HIV and AIDS.
In my judgment, and to the best of my reviewing of the current literature on that subject, I've never seen a clear demonstration, I mean, of a direct isolation of HIV from patients. I've seen some evidence of virus particles observed occasionally in very complex culture systems. But this, to me, is no evidence for direct isolation from the patients.
It's been isolated by thousands of laboratories throughout the world. It's probably the best studied virus of any viral pathogen in the history of human diseases. So to say that it doesn't exist and it hasn't been isolated is beyond preposterous.
What AIDS researchers call virus isolation, or HIV isolation in this case, consists of two things. They will get their tissue culture where this HIV is supposed to be growing, and they'll check it for reverse transcriptase, which is an enzyme that was supposed to be specific or only exclusively found in retroviruses. And if they find reverse transcriptase in the tissue culture, they say, aha, we have now isolated HIV. Another thing they'll do is they'll check the tissue culture for a P24 antigen, which is one of the proteins that supposedly belongs to HIV. Both of these things, reverse transcriptase and the P24 protein, are about as nonspecific as you can get. In fact, reverse transcriptase can be found in any number of different places. Normal cells contain reverse transcriptase, and under certain conditions, they will reverse transcribe RNA into DNA. The hepatitis B virus also contains reverse transcriptase. And most importantly of all, the cells of people with leukemia have also been shown to have reverse transcriptase activity. And why this is important is that every HIV culture, starting with Robert Gallo, were co-cultured with leukemia tissue. You couldn't just take the blood from somebody with AIDS and culture it in the tissue culture all by itself, because nothing would grow. They couldn't find any HIV that way. So they had to co-culture it with cancer cells or tissue from people with leukemia.
We know what is reverse transcription. That's the repair of mechanism of the ends of the chromosomes. Yeah? And therefore we have high activity in cancer cells or Montagnier embryonic cells. But Montagnier never said that he found the virus of AIDS. He said this could be probably an effect and to be carefully studied.
Now, of all the years and the decades that have gone by where people have studied retroviruses, researchers have concluded that they all share certain common characteristics. First of all, they have a certain density which causes them to band at the 1.16 grams per milliliter density gradient. Their morphological characteristics have to fulfill certain requirements. First of all, they have to be round. They can have a diameter of between 100 and 120 nanometers, no more, no less. They have to have dense cores, and they have to have spikes or knobs on the surface. Well, in terms of AIDS, we didn't even find any retroviruses there in the density gradient. In fact, 80% of the material that ends up there is cellular material, just garbage, really, from the cells of the tissue culture. And the remaining 20% may or may not be a retrovirus. Just because it ends up there doesn't mean you've proved it's a retrovirus.
If you take any material of cellular origin and put it on the sucrose gradient, you also will get a band at the density of 1.16, but you better make sure you don't declare that this band is pure virus unless you do a careful control of what's in that band by electron microscopy. And I believe that for some reason that control, which is essential in retroviral research, has been neglected for about 15 years, and that has had disastrous effects.
If you want, you can spend a fortune and take electron microscopic pictures, which we did at the beginning, and which other labs did at the beginning, in which there are hundreds of them. Oh yeah, of course. Yeah. There's, I would say by now, thousands of pictures of HIV. We have drawers full, stacks full, this high of electron micrographs. Okay, pictures of the virus. So, but
banded
once
material.
You picture, once you
banded material 1.16.
No, you can look at banded material. You can obvious retrovirus. Do you know what a retrovirus looks like?
I have a picture showing what a density gradient of pure virus should look like. In the way that you determine if something is pure is to stare at one object, take in its appearance, and then look at every other object around it and make sure that they're the same. And you can see that mostly this is pure particles. There are some where these are arrowed which are slightly different, and this is not unusual. However, in March 1997 in Virology, and published by Glushenkov from France, the first pictures of purified virus were revealed to the world. You can see from this that this material is anything but pure. In fact, the authors of this paper concede that this so-called pure virus is predominantly cellular material.
The particles that were found in these two 1997 studies did not fit the characteristics of retroviruses. They had no knobs on them, and they were the wrong size. In fact, the volumes of the particles in these studies were either anywhere from 50% greater to 750% greater than the volume that a normal retrovirus particle really ought to be.
Now, it seems hard to believe, but this material that retrovirologists, including Montagnier and Gallo, were isolating from their cultures, labeling pure HIV, and producing by the thousands of gallons in order to make proteins for the HIV antibody test and for other research purposes, was never examined under an electron microscope in order to determine that this material contained pure retroviral particles. Now, I say it was never examined under a microscope. I assume that some scientists must have examined it under an electron microscope, but no photographs of this examination were ever published in the scientific literature. You know, one can only guess why they weren't.
If you take a culture which has never had a retrovirus added to it, and you put it on the bench and wait for a week or two, it may actually start to produce retroviral particles and the other phenomena which go with retroviruses spontaneously. You can increase the rate of appearance of this and the yield many times, millions of times, by irradiating the cultures or by adding the same stimulating agents that are used in AIDS cultures, or by culturing with other cells, co-cultures, as are used to isolate HIV, or just fluids from other cell cultures. And these viruses are called endogenous retroviruses because they come from within and not from without. And the reason that they appear is because we inherit DNA which can actually be made to go to work to actually produce these phenomena, these particles. This is actually called endogenous retroviral expression. I mean, we're looking at 1% of the human genome as being made up of endogenous retroviral information, instructions sitting there waiting to make retroviruses when switched on by some stimulus. And so we don't know if HIV is a genuine retrovirus, that it may in fact be endogenous, and it may be the result of getting AIDS and not the cause. I mean, this will not be the first time that this has happened. Retrovirologists themselves in the past have in fact postulated that diseases may cause retroviruses and not the other way around.
Retroviral-like particles are practically ubiquitous everywhere in cell cultures. You simply can't point to one in an impure cell culture and call it HIV. Even Robert Gallo admits that particles that look like retroviruses but aren't retroviruses because they can't reproduce are found not only in impure cell cultures, but even in the band associated, the density band associated with purified HIV particles. You need more evidence than that before you can point to one of these particles in a cell culture and say it's HIV. Unfortunately, these particles are reproduced by the thousands in newspapers, in magazines. They're the basis of artists' conceptions that you see in Newsweek and Time. None of them have been proven by standard means that we have at our disposal to be not simply retroviruses, but a unique retrovirus, HIV.
Little wonder the public is confused about the subject of HIV testing. For on the one hand, we're told to take the AIDS test. The AIDS test is to determine, will we get AIDS? Do we have the HIV virus? Which will then mean we will eventually have AIDS and die. But all one has to do is open the test kit, look at the literature inside the test kit, and clearly it says that this should not be used as interpreting a person has AIDS or HIV virus. Well, therefore, if the test is not testing for the presence of a disease state or even an antibody that could precipitate a disease state, then what is its value?
There are two tests in common use. One's called the ELISA, the other's called the Western blot. The only difference between them is that in the ELISA test, all the so-called HIV proteins, about 10 of them, are all mixed up together in a solution. And in the Western blot, prior to reacting, the proteins have been separated out into a nitrocellulose strip. Now, the test that really matters in all this is the Western blot. So we really don't need to discuss the ELISA test. It's used as a screening test, and it is admitted by experts that it is not sufficiently specific to diagnose HIV infection, whereas the Western blot, if positive, is considered synonymous with HIV infection.
The standard screening test is an ELISA. Occasionally you get a false positive. Under those circumstances, a Western blot can absolutely confirm. Western blots are also important when you have people, for example, who have been vaccinated in vaccine trials and making antibody against one protein. The only way you're going to tell if they're infected serologically is by looking at a Western blot showing they make antibodies to the other protein. So it has a lot of value. It's fundamentally a confirmatory diagnostic test.
This is representing a Western blot strip. And a Western blot strip is a thin strip, like the strip that your doctor uses to test your urine. And in it, on the strip, are placed several proteins, 10 of them in the case of HIV, separated by their molecular weights. And in the test, plasma is added to the strip, and if there are antibodies in the plasma which react with any of these proteins, then the strip turns dark. So a Western blot test appears as a series of horizontal, dark horizontal bands. Now, one of the problems of the Western blot test is that it is not reproducible. This is a test of a positive serum performed in 19 reference laboratories, all on the same specimen of blood. And as you can see, just by looking at this, no two are alike.
The proteins used on that Western blot strip that scientists claim are HIV proteins may not necessarily be HIV proteins. There's no proof that they are, and there's plenty of evidence that these are normal human cellular proteins that have been misidentified. This conclusion seems hardly debatable in the case of P32, one of these purportedly HIV proteins that's been shown to be identical in amino acid sequence to a normal human protein associated with human T cell function. Another one of these proteins, P41, has been considered by Montagnier's group, Montagnier, the original discoverer of HIV, to be a contaminant, the ubiquitous cellular protein actin. Yet it's right there on your Western blot test, masquerading as an HIV protein.
It's nearly impossible to determine the rate of false positives because there is no gold standard to independently verify test results. People with non-AIDS diseases have antibodies that can register a positive result on the HIV antibody test. Indeed, people with multiple sclerosis, T-cell lymphoma, generalized warts, and other diseases have the P24 antigen.
And we also know that AIDS patients, despite being immune deficient, have lots of antibodies, more antibodies than healthy people. And many of these antibodies react with cellular proteins. That's just data that's widely available and not disputed. And we also know, or we can bet, that AIDS patients also contain other infectious agents, such as other viruses, because we all know that if someone gets needle stuck from an AIDS patient, it's not just HIV that people are worrying about catching. You're more likely to develop antibodies to hepatitis B virus than HIV, 30 times more likely. So we can bet that the proteins from other viruses will be present in the cultures as well.
Based upon the HIV equals AIDS hypothesis, they then gave us the test. Now,
they didn't give it to us, they sold it to us.
Now, who sold it to us? Who owns, who gets this money?
Bob Gallo himself was getting quite a bit off of it. He had to give a lot back to Montagnier when it was finally proven that he stole the virus from Montagnier in the first place. But Montagnier and the Pasteur Institute are getting a dollar, I think, or so every time somebody gets an HIV test.
When he came up with his first test, he tested 30% of the American blood donators, so let's say the general population, he tested them positive. And the industry said, no, go home, Gallo. We won't buy your test because this is going to destroy our business. And the only thing what he did, he lowered the sensitivity of the antibody test. And that you can read in your library. You shouldn't believe me a single word. That's about science. Check it. I'm not speaking about thesis, opinions, or you know things, you know, foggy things. No, everything it's there, and we reach the bottom line. There's no way out. They designed a test to select gay people, and when of course he's stimulating the cell with all kind of mitogens, carcinogens, and he of course added hydrocortisone, which he hasn't published. But this matters. They added hydrocortisone like people under persistent stress, hypercortisolism, that the same proteins are produced.
There's also data from a number of hospitals in the US, which was published in 1988, where they tested nearly 90,000 blood samples anonymously on hospital patients. And these patients were selected to have no risks for HIV infection or AIDS. In some of the hospitals, they found 25% of men were HIV positive on the Western blot, the most specific test, and they found that 8% of women were HIV positive on the Western blot. I mean, this should lead one to question again, how do that many people who have no risk for HIV or AIDS get to have that many HIV antibodies?
Being HIV positive puts you in a precarious position where your health can be judged in a way that no one else's health is judged. And when you're a woman and you're pregnant or you have a family, it presents a danger. When I was pregnant and I did not want to go on the drug therapies, had I had any of the problems that my HIV negative pregnant friends had, such as chronic yeast infections or even toxoplasmosis, I would have been considered having AIDS, and I would have been considered more irresponsible than I already was for having ever gotten pregnant in the first place, and I would have decidedly risked having my son taken away from me at birth.
There's so many factors that can even cause a false positive, from flu vaccine to herpes or venereal disease, alcoholism, and you can be told that you're positive and not even be positive, whatever that means. I have friends who've been through this, a friend who went through years of being told he was positive till he went to another doctor who said, we're not finding anything, we're using all of our tests. And now he's confused and goes back and forth. There's no oversight in any of this, but they're terrorizing and ripping people's lives apart with unsupportable data.
Nobody can find free infectious HIV virus in a human being. That is why they have to resort to looking for antibodies to HIV in a person. That is one of the biggest flaws in the HIV hypothesis, that antibodies, which are a sign of immunity, you should be happy that you have antibodies. It means that you are now immune. And yet with AIDS, we have antibodies as a predictor or an indicator of AIDS and future death. That doesn't make any sense to me.
In different countries or institutions or laboratories around the world, what is criteria used to define a positive Western blot test vary considerably. That is, the number of bands required vary considerably. And here we have on the chart several different institutions, France, United Kingdom, Germany, some American institutions, the US Red Cross, the FDA. And you can see by looking at this chart that just about every lane is different. Now, this has some interesting implications. For instance, in Australia, which is the second lane, you need four bands to be deemed HIV infected. In fact, Australia is probably the hardest country, in fact, in which to be deemed HIV positive. But in other parts of the world, you don't need that many bands. In Africa, you need two. In some parts of America, you need two. In some parts of America, you need three. And in the MAC study, the multi-center AIDS cohort study, up till 1990, just one band was considered sufficient to diagnose a gay man HIV infected.
When you have indeterminate bands and you don't have the full array of them, then there's obviously the iffy situation where you need to repeat it. But I don't think that there's anything wrong with different countries having different criteria, because the different criteria are only really for that small group of patients that come in the indeterminate level. When a Western blot is really positive, it hits you like a truck. It's only for that little indeterminate group that you have to be concerned.
This means, in theory at least, that if you were tested in New York today, then flew to Australia, and you had three bands in New York, you would not be positive in Australia, but you would be positive in New York City. Now, I mean, a virus cannot behave in this manner. And this is what has led us to hypothesize that there is no proof that any person with a positive antibody test, no matter how defined, is in fact infected with this so-called lethal retrovirus.
Since 1992, there is no Western blot in Great Britain, because they saw it's a waste of money, you know. It's the same principle.
Well, the bulk of the world uses it. If some technology comes across better, I'd be the first to say, do it. I mean, obviously, the Western blot's a valuable test as defining the proteins that you have antibodies to. Everybody uses it experimentally, and most people use it clinically around the world. Maybe Britain doesn't use it. Maybe there are two countries that found a better way. God bless them.
If they didn't allow them to charge so much for it, I think there'll be a lot less use of it. You know, it's just like in political scandals. Follow the money trail. Figure out who's getting paid for this. Who's getting the money for those Western blots? There's your person who's going to always come down on the side of, yeah, you got a confirmatory Western blots, they call it. You know, do a confirmatory Western blot. Well, let's see. And those things are so hokey, it's just ridiculous. I didn't know they don't even do them in England anymore.
No,
but
not since 1992.
It's totally, and ask a doctor how it works. The doctor who prescribes it says, got to have a Western blot to confirm this ELISA positive thing. How does that work, doctor? Sir, what are they now measuring about me that's different from what they measured with the ELISA test? He wouldn't know. He's not got any idea. I'll bet you there's scarcely 50 physicians in this country that know what a Western blot really is. They know when to order it, and they know they get a kickback on it, probably. They make some money from having to take the blood or whatever. And they make money by prescribing AZT. They get money every time they turn around. They get money.
If there's one way we've been told AIDS is transmitted, it's sexually. What is the evidence that AIDS is sexually transmitted? much evidence exists to the contrary.
The statistics have been confirmed over and over again, most recently just last year from the University of California at San Francisco, that it takes, on average, 1,000 sexual contacts with an HIV person or persons in order to become HIV positive yourself. That means 1,000. Put that in comparison with typical sexually transmitted diseases. It takes, on average, 2 to 3 sexual contacts to get gonorrhea or syphilis, for example. Now, the CDC has estimated a constant 1 million Americans infected with HIV over the past 10 years, constant number. That right there should be a giveaway. It's not spreading in society.
That's not an epidemic. The number of cases reported went up epidemically, you know, exponentially, because the number of tests that was done went up exponentially. The first time I ever saw one of these CDC graphs, it showed this thing going off the page. You know, I went up after that and I said, how did you disentangle did you divide the number that you've got here by the number of tests that were done? I mean, can we believe that this line that you've drawn here about number of positive tests reported, is that really indicative of the spread of this virus? Is the virus getting, is there being more of it, or are there more tests? If you divide by the number of tests you do, you don't get any kind of a curve going up. It's just, how many doctors knew about HIV in 1983? 2. How many knew about it in 1985? Say 500. How many knew about it in 1986? 40,000. So that's where the curve came from. How many tests were done? Same thing. How many tests? They could have just said, how much money did we make off of HIV this year? And they could have plotted that, and it would have looked the same. You know, and they could have said, it's an epidemic, because we're making more and more money off of it every year.
The heterosexual epidemic certainly hasn't seen it materialized in Australia. For example, in 1991, 10 years after AIDS commenced, researchers were able to write that no Australian prostitutes had been infected through sexual intercourse. None.
In the MAX study, as far back as 1987, they have shown that in this prospective study, the only sexual act directly related to the development of the phenomenon which is called HIV and of AIDS was passive anal intercourse. By 1997, Nancy Padian has proven that AIDS cannot be heterosexually transmitted. They had couples there who either one or the other was positive, and they were followed up for more than 6 years. And although nearly 25% of the couples were not using condoms, still no one of the negative couples ever seroconverted. So there is ample evidence that HIV cannot be sexually transmitted.
The thing about safe sex, and using condoms, I think it is important to use condoms, but not for HIV. I think it's important for other, like, sexually transmitted diseases and just general hygiene.
If it's just caused by needles, or it's just caused by homosexual activities, you're not going to really get a long, sustained public outcry against it, and nobody's going to want to spend $6 billion a year. They're going to say, well, we really didn't like those people anyhow. Great. I can't think of a better solution to the homosexual problem than a disease that'll kill them all. I mean, there would be congressmen that would talk about that quietly, not on television. So the CDC had to say, we can't say that. We've got to say it's got to be heterosexually transmitted. There's no proof that it's transmitted at all at that point. So why not just say, well, it's heterosexually transmitted too. It must be in semen. And when they looked for it in semen, they didn't find it. They had no evidence that it was sexually transmitted or any other way transmitted. They just said it because that made it a plague, and the CDC needed one. The CDC hadn't had a good plague since polio. Their funding was probably going to be cut back if they didn't come up with one. The guy that was the head of the CDC, in fact, wrote memos that have been obtained, you know, that where he describes this as hot stuff. You know, those guys have got an agenda, which is not what we would like them to have, being that we pay for them to take care of our health in some way.
the whole idea of sexual freedom and the puritanical America that has reacted to that since the 60s sexual revolution, it fits right into what they want to do. It says that if you have sex, you can die, literally. And it just so fits that whole fundamentalist Christian right perspective. So somebody's pleased by this. And so the right-wing conservative side of America, the anti-sexual freedom side, is very pleased with this whole AIDS epidemic.
Gay sex is not a disease. It's been happening throughout history. Whatever's happening now is something different, but we've been taught to be afraid to be gay and for people to be afraid of gay sex.
There were people who felt that a single virus theory would be useful in helping to raise public awareness about the disease. It would help them get the research they thought was necessary and public funding for its treatment by scaring people into believing that while the disease was affecting gay men now, it was eventually going to spread throughout the heterosexual population. This political definition of the disease has proven to be inaccurate and inconsistent with its real medical nature.
The CDC catches wind of this phenomenon happening among gay men, and they believe that it's a virus that's to blame. Now, of course, there's no historical precedent for believing that a single virus could devastate a normal immune system, but the individual at the CDC investigating this situation on the task force regarding Kaposi sarcoma and opportunistic infections were all infectious disease specialists. They're used to blaming viruses for diseases, and that was their leading theory from the get-go. And in order to validate this theory that a virus was to blame for these immunodeficiencies among gay men, they actively sought out other cases of unexplained immunodeficiency throughout the U.S. in other populations. And lo and behold, they found unexplained diseases of immunodeficiency among IV drug users. I'm sorry, you know, you've got a similar situation. Exposure to innumerable microbes, typically through unhygienic needle use, and heavy-duty drug use among this population of IV drug users. Is it so surprising that they would have immune problems? I mean, junkies are famous for dying of opportunistic infections, including pneumonias. Soon enough, they identified immunodeficiency diseases among hemophiliacs. And they published this finding, much to the astoundment of scientists, doctors, and the general public. It seemed that the virus causing the immunodeficiencies among gay men, that had spread through needle use to IV drug users, had spread through factor VIII to hemophiliacs. Factor VIII was a new blood product used among hemophiliacs in order to restore their blood clotting capability. The difficulty with factor VIII was that due to purification technology in the 1970s, factor VIII was a terribly impure blood product. In fact, it was 99 to 99.9% impure, meaning that it was loaded with other viruses and foreign proteins from as many as 10,000 donors per dose of factor VIII, which meant that over the course of a year, a regular user of factor VIII might be exposed to the foreign viruses and proteins of upwards of 2 million different blood donors. Now that in itself can be terribly immune suppressive, but the CDC preferred to believe that the immune problems among hemophiliacs was also caused by a virus. And the CDC went on to identify immune problems among babies, all of whom in the early years were born to drug-addicted mothers, and identify immune problems among transfusion victims. And you've got transfusion victims who are getting blood transfusions which have been shown to be immunosuppressive. As a matter of fact, in the 1970s, medical scientists had begun infusing organ receivers with donated blood before receiving their new organs, because that donated blood was shown to suppress their immune system and hence prevent organ rejection. So you've got several populations in which there are perfectly plausible alternative explanations for immune suppression and related diseases.
The only clinical picture which the different risk groups have in common, that's hepatitis. You don't find a single biopsy-confirmed PCP in hemophiliacs or in drug abusers other than homosexuals. But they overcame the problem that every gay person who admits drug abuse would be in the list of drug abusers. So they have some PCP cases. But a drug abuser or a drug abusing woman not using poppers, never comes down with PCP. They have the definition for women with AIDS, that's candida of the throat, right? Not of the mouth, but even when a medical doctor sees a little bit candida in the mouth, they would say it's an AIDS case, even when tested negative. That's also very, very important, that
you don't need a positive test. You, even a negative test would declare you to be an AIDS case when they confirm that you have a PCP.
For more than 15 years, one of the indicators to determine do you have AIDS, how sick are you with AIDS, is your T-cell count. We've been led to believe that by measuring our T4 and 8 helper cells, that it will indicate how far along we are in our progression. The lower the T-cell count, the more sick you are.
Now, the CDC muddied the waters somewhat in 1993 when it added a new condition to the definition of AIDS, which was T-cell counts under 200. Now, since 1993, if you have an HIV antibody test that's positive and a T-cell count under 200, you can be considered an AIDS patient. Now, this is quite an innovation. As of last year, according to the CDC's own statistics, 65% of patients who've been diagnosed with AIDS in the calendar year of 1997 were diagnosed solely on the basis of having a positive HIV test and low T-cell counts. Not on the basis of a disease like pneumocystis pneumonia or Kaposi's sarcoma. They were diagnosed with a deadly illness on the basis of two laboratory findings, an HIV positive test and a T-cell count under 200. And the problem with a T-cell count under 200 is that it's never been shown to be a valid indicator of illness. In the only study of its kind of HIV negative healthy individuals, it appeared in the Journal of the American Medical Association in 1992, T-cell counts of these individuals were found to range from 237 to 1817. So suddenly we're looking at a 200 T-cell count as something on the low end of normal. But if you're HIV positive and you have a T-cell count under 200 just once, then you're considered a victim of a deadly disease and considered an AIDS statistic. You know, suddenly a whole lot of people can qualify for an AIDS diagnosis on that basis and for a lot of government funding.
Certainly, T4 decrease cannot be considered the hallmark of AIDS because it appears in many patients who never develop AIDS. In fact, all you have to do to have a decreased T4 cell is to go on the beach and lie there for a few hours. And if you measure your T4 cells, more than likely, they will be very low.
It's not possible to measure the strength of your immune system using the blood. It makes no sense because only 2% of those white blood cells or lymphocytes are said to be responsible for immune functions are in the blood. All the others are in the tissues where they have to do their work. It's like looking outside to the street, onto the street, and counting the police cars coming by every day, and you would count 10 usually, but suddenly only 3, and then you would say 7 of those policemen caught up or were killed by the virus mafia in the Bronx. But that's completely mistaken. They are probably somewhere else to do their job, and that's how it works in our body.
Part of the fear that accompanies this issue is if I do nothing to fight my HIV, something will happen in the future. Something, the HIV will come and get me 10 or 15 years down the line. This is what we're told to believe. That sort of fear is very powerful. It makes people who've stopped taking the drugs go back on the drugs, even if they're doing fine, but their surrogate markers change, the viral load and T-cell counts change. That's another part of the fear. That's psychological terror, plain and simple. Nothing else is behind those markers. It's a numbers game that doctors play, knowingly or not, with their patients. And their patients buy into that for the most part and are led by this fear.
I don't think there are any infectious diseases in which everybody who's infected gets sick. I mean, usually it's the minority of people. Poliovirus used to infect many, many, many more people and became paralyzed. Hepatitis B affects many people that don't even know it. They get better and they're fine. It kills other people. So it's not so straightforward. And the notion that HIV, almost everybody dies from it, would make it, in my more traditional view, a very radical kind of way out notion, which is coming from our established medical profession, who one would have thought would have been a little bit more conservative.
To say that all of you have to die
how unfair, how unjust, how cruel. They went too far, you know, declaring an absolute death sentence in AIDS. From the first five cases, only two died, the three survived. So that's very clear that they built it up a system of belief, because they were misusing the gay scene of New York City from 78 till 80 in order to isolate the hepatitis B vaccine out of them. So they perfectly knew already what kind of proteins and what kind of antiproteins, the antibodies, they have inside their blood and inside their body. So it was very easy for the ones who set up antibody tests to produce similar proteins like the body would produce under persistent stress. And that has been done.
Many believe that thousands of people have died, not because of an HIV virus, but because of the medications aggressively given in otherwise healthy asymptomatic individuals.
Think about Septrim, you know. The FDA says this should be given only 14 days maximum. Otherwise, your own blood picture is going to be destroyed irreversibly, means for the rest of the life, because the damages became inherited. Because it's Septrim, it's pure chemotherapy, it acts on a genetic level. This is why those kind of antibiotics are so effective, because they are destroying the genetic material of the bacteria, the damages are accumulating, and there is no repair. But the damages are accumulating inside our cells as well, and therefore, this is the reason why AIDS, it's of greatest importance to everybody, but out of completely different reason, because humankind is in danger to destroy its own genetic material using this kind of antibiotica and chemotherapy, which would destroy the genetic material of our mitochondria. This is the name of those bacteria inside our cell producing the energy. And then we go lower and lower with energy production, and this is what we are seeing. And if we then have no regenerative power, then it becomes a big, big problem.
I've done most of my work on ACT, which first started being prescribed in 1987. And that's a long story, but I've shown that the original drug trials, the phase two studies, were blatantly fraudulent, proving nothing. And yet it was the basis for the approval of ACT, not only in the United States, but 30 other countries.
During the 3 years that I participated in the early AZT clinical trials, I witnessed the most shocking, unethical, unscientific, and corrupt behavior by the clinicians conducting these studies. For anyone who believes that AZT was proven to be safe or effective, I would never claim that based on the results of the studies that I participated in. Whenever there was an adverse reaction or something that could have been an adverse reaction to the experimental drug, this information was supposed to have been recorded on an as-needed form. Some kind of a adverse reaction such as diarrhea or weight loss or night sweats or vomiting or fevers or the development of an opportunistic infection. Often these things were not recorded. And so how would you really know if there were adverse reactions to these drugs if they were routinely left out of the data? It was often the case that patients would not even be asked to sign informed consent forms, or often that they were asked to sign these forms weeks or even months after they had been enrolled on the study. There were many patients who developed blood toxicities. There were many patients who experienced other symptoms of adverse reactions. And think of all the people today who are still taking AZT. Think of all the people who died from what we think was AIDS. Were those people, in fact, killed by AZT?
After 87, cancer of the lymph system, which is directly caused by AZT, and that has been studied in the 60s, and that has been the reason why AZT has been forbidden since then in animals, because it killed all of them and caused cancer of the lymphatic system before.
Glaxo welcomes inserts to the physicians and the physician's desk reference, warns the doctors not to confuse the toxic effects of AZT with AIDS itself. AZT causes numerous AIDS-defining diseases. For example, AZT causes dementia, which is AIDS-defining. AZT causes diarrhea. AZT causes muscle wasting. It causes a whole host of complications. It destroys the bone marrow, requiring life-saving blood transfusions of people that use AZT. This information you get from GlaxoWelcome itself, the manufacturer. So I don't know who better else to go to.
The antiviral drugs are chemotherapies. They're all based on chemotherapies that have been developed 30 years ago, long before AIDS was known, to kill human cells, to kill cancer cells. Hopefully, that's the operating principle of chemotherapy. You kill all growing cells. You want to kill cancer cells, but you have to kill all growing cells because you work with a so-called DNA chain terminator, a substance that terminates the synthesis of the central molecule of life, that is DNA. And then when that is terminated, adios cell. The cell is going to die, and sooner or later, you're going to die. Chemotherapy is restricted to a few months in the hope the cancer dies before you die. That's why it has to be restricted. But antiviral therapy, a chemotherapy now used for the first time in the history again of virology, never mind the extremely detrimental effect to human cells. Not accidental, not side effects. The designer effects on human cells. These are chemotherapies designed to kill human cells.
What if you were to take completely healthy individuals who had no risk factors for depressing their immune system, and every day, four times a day, you give them one of the most toxic chemotherapy drugs ever created, AZT? What would you imagine would be the state of their immune system and overall health within 2 years? And yet that's exactly what has been done with many people who have tested positive for the HIV antibody.
The doctor says, okay, yes, we have here sick people and we treat them, we try to treat them, but we only treat them because we hear from them they have a deadly virus, not because they are sick. Most of them are completely healthy. They are just afraid.
We watch people come in, they'll be taking the medications and they're, you know, looking gaunt, their skin's turning funny colors, they're real anemic, they're weak, sometimes coming in with canes. They do a little research on their own. We don't tell them what to do. We're about self-empowerment, self-responsibility, taking charge of your own life and health. They begin doing that, they get off the medications, color starts coming back, they start putting on the weight, they start feeling better. But there's a lapse, they get afraid again, they start taking the medications, we watch them start shrinking up again, they start looking gaunt, they start getting pale again, they start getting weak. Then they go, oh, maybe I should be doing this. They get off, they start coming back again. You actually watch this, and it's coordinated with taking these medications. It's just unmistakable. One of the biggest things that's missing in science today is common sense.
1987 was the year that there was a big rise in the mortality rates of HIV-positive hemophiliacs. 1987 was also the year that AZT was introduced as a therapeutic for AIDS and also administered to hemophiliacs that were HIV positive. And I'm pretty convinced that the rise in the mortality of these hemophiliacs is a direct consequence of the toxic effects of the AZT. AZT was so toxic in the 1960s that it was never used in humans. In fact, it was so toxic it was considered worthless. That's why they didn't even patent it. I'm also concerned with the growing number of states that are passing laws requiring pregnant women to be tested for antibodies to HIV. Following the passage of these laws, it's a short step to compelling or intimidating these women to take these poisons and also to give these poisons to their babies.
When a woman is pregnant in this country, she's told not to be around cigarette smoke, drink coffee, alcohol. Yet we're telling a woman who tests positive on a non-specific test for antibodies that may or may not have anything to do with HIV that the only reasonable response is to take a drug that terminates DNA chains as they're forming, that causes immune suppression, anemia, seizures, muscle wasting that causes damage to the mitochondria of the cells that has been shown to produce infants with incredibly horrible birth defects ranging from webbed fingers to misshapen heads to holes in their chest to mental retardation. This is wrong. Women who test HIV positive and are pregnant are having their children taken away from them or being threatened with loss of custody if they don't comply with what the Centers for Disease Control acknowledges are recommendations for therapy and protocols. Testing HIV positive when you're pregnant can be simply a result of being pregnant. One of the first cross reactions on HIV tests that were ever noted was pregnancy itself.
You have a self-fulfilling prophecy. The more people are treated against AIDS, the more people will eventually develop AIDS from it. And then the perfect excuse is delivered with the medication. You can say, Jesus, if I hadn't medicated you, you would have been sick even sooner and would have died sooner. But thanks to my medication, you are only getting sick now, and we're giving you even more medication. We need more money to develop further medications that have yet to cure the first AIDS patients. The old paradigm in science is first you find the cause and then you treat the cause. Well, with AIDS, we have violated both. We have assumed the cause, have never proved it. We have assumed it was infectious. We have assumed among all infectious agents, this virus does it. We have been unable to prove it. And we have cured and cured and cured against this virus with the result of 600,000 patients, 350,000. Dead and not a single cure in sight. We are claiming more and more money to continue the same vicious cycle.
Who really benefits from the billions upon billions of dollars spent each year on AIDS research?
Those that control and maintain the HIV hypothesis of AIDS are two basic institutions: the Centers for Disease Control, the CDC, and the National Institutes of Health in Bethesda, Maryland. Both of these institutions will probably come as a surprise to the public to learn that they are military organizations. It was certainly a surprise to me to learn this. The leaders of the National Institutes of Health and the CDC have uniforms. They have military ranks. And as everybody who's ever been in the military knows, there's an information flow from top to bottom. Military structures are incompatible with free and open discourse and debate, which is supposed to be what science is about. When you have these military structures in the CDC and the National Institutes of Health, you can control the debate. You can control the information flow. Not only that, since the National Institutes of Health are the primary source of funding for all academic, medical, scientific research, they can control who gets funding to do what research. And in that fashion, they can control what gets published and, more importantly, what you exclude.
For more than 15 years, the American public had been told that the HIV virus is the sole cause of AIDS. Those members of the scientific community who have questioned this dogma, the three-part equation HIV equals AIDS and equals death, have been suppressed.
Peter Duisberg at the University of California, Berkeley campus, is seen, as is often done with maverick scientists or others, as someone who is now dangerous. This is typically the way such mavericks are treated. His funding has been cut off. Graduate students are encouraged not to take his courses, and I think his administrative duties have included being in charge of the department picnic. This is a brilliant scientist who should be and is at the height of his powers, and he has not been treated as one would expect of, one, a brilliant scientist, and two, a supposedly liberal campus like the University of California at Berkeley.
Peter is a very scholarly person in addition to being brilliant, too. He's very careful. He doesn't say anything that he can't support. and also the most, one of the most brilliant people in, surely the most brilliant virologist, possibly the most brilliant, you know, molecular biologist around. He was a really well thought of guy too, because of his ideas, the whole field. I mean, in cancer, he's the guy that led him into the whole oncogene thing, you know? Big research bonanza. Anybody who could order a little kit from some company and hire a couple of technicians could be a cancer researcher because of things that Peter opened up. And then Peter said, no, I don't think that's actually the cause of cancer. And that made those guys a little bit angry. And then he comes along and does the same thing for AIDS. He said, you know, I think we're on the wrong track here. And for some reason, you know, the second time, it was almost like nobody even had to argue with him. Oh, it's just Peter again, ruining our fun, telling us that all this easy research stuff that we know we can do now for years and the American people will pay for it, that we can't, we're not, that we shouldn't be doing that. And Peter did that again. He did that twice. We need a lot more Peters.
In 1978, started a new era, a new stage in medicine, and it started in the milk workers in Michigan. There was an epidemic of severe immune deficiency in farmers who were working with milk, because the milk got polluted or contaminated with some chemicals. These chemicals were poisons for the cows and were co-poison for the farmers who were working with them. And both of them, both the farmers and the cows, got AIDS-like diseases. And this is new. This never happened before. So I think that's why nowadays we have a new branch of specialization in medicine, that is immunotoxicology.
If you check the first publications on AIDS, and you will see that we have five young men. All of them had the use of nitrites reported, and those nitrites were used for sexual stimulation, but they are very dangerous. They are oxidizing the blood. And if the blood is oxidized, no energy is produced inside the body, because we need the oxygen to produce energy. And I think everybody knows this. And if this is not possible, of course, the lung itself suffers first. And when the lung suffers, there's no replacement of the old and dying cells. Fungal infections have the possibility to come in and to feed on those and this dead or dying organic matter. And this condition is called PCP. And that's a fungal infection. That's not a protozoan or bacterial infection, which is waiting inside the body till the immune system is going to go down.
You know how you give pneumocystis to a rat if you want to? Put him on a low-protein diet and give him some steroids for about 6 weeks, and he'll get pneumocystis. These guys are doing that same thing. Low-protein diet and a lot of steroids. I mean, all kinds of steroids. And that's the known way. I mean, that's what the people that study pneumocystis, that's the way they produce a rat model for pneumocystis.
What we see, and this is consistent in all industrialized countries, United States, Europe, 60% have fungal infections, 20% have cancer. And the rest are some rare forms of unicellular organisms. Of course, in the beginning they thought a lot of bacterial infections would show up. So they added the bacterial infections inside the definition of AIDS, but then they have to take them out because they didn't show up. And why should established diseases form a new syndrome? We know the conditions why somebody comes down with fungal infections, and of course we know the treatment options to help the body to regenerate, to produce the needed energy, right?
Babies who are born out of with AIDS are babies who are exposed during pregnancy to different immunological stressors. In Africa or in the Caribbean, in Haiti and Trinidad and Tobago, babies who are born of AIDS because their mothers are exposed to malnutrition during pregnancy. And babies who are born with AIDS in America or in Europe are because the mothers are exposed to chemicals or drug of abuse or industrial chemicals. But why never before babies were having AIDS? Because toxins were there before, a lot of toxins. I think that the thing is a problem of a dosage, of amount. I think never before the human being have been exposed to the amount of stress that we have been exposed in the last 3 or 4 decades. So never before the babies were exposed during pregnancy of the mothers to the amount of stressors that they are exposed nowadays. In other words, what I'm trying to say is that all babies are born nowadays a little weaker than they were born 100 years ago. And some of them whose mothers are exposed to higher amount of stressors during pregnancy are shown these new conditions.
Professor Duisberg proposed that it is not this relatively harmless retrovirus, the HIV virus, that could be causing all of this death and disease. Instead, it was recreational drug use. By examining this subculture of the underground fast-track gay community, as well as intravenous drug users within the heterosexual community, were the ones who were being diagnosed with AIDS or suffering from the AIDS-related illnesses.
The third of all American AIDS patients, of the 600,000 American AIDS patients, are intravenous drug users. All the heterosexual AIDS patients, even the babies with AIDS, are in this category. Well, the babies have not injected drugs, but their mothers did. 200,000 American mothers are injecting drugs every year, and they are the mothers of the 1,000 or so AIDS babies that we have in this country.
What is the evidence that drugs are really responsible for the AIDS-defining diseases in the United States and Europe? Well, there is some direct evidence. The nitrites, the so-called poppers, are responsible for the Kaposi sarcoma that is exclusively seen in gay men, at least 98% of it is, and 100% of these men have a history of inhaling these poppers. The nitrites are directly immune suppressive. That is documented in the scientific literature. They're some of the most potent carcinogens and mutagens known.
This continues to be confirmed in large cohort studies of male homosexuals at risk for AIDS, that they use these drugs to this very day. And it should go on to this date. Why do I say that? Because the medical orthodoxy, the virologists, the doctors treating AIDS patients, the scientific community does not accept the view that drugs could cause anything. That the drugs would cause the damage is not acceptable hypothesis in America and in Europe these days. You are supposed to think that only a virus could do harm. Drugs are harmless. And in the world's most popular scientific journal of all, Science, an article appeared on the same question, which in fact said in 1994 that heroin is a pleasantly untoxic drug. The only trouble could be that you might, because you're high, forget to wear a condom and forget to use a clean needle, and then you get infected by HIV. It said that in the same year in which 3,500 fellow Americans died from heroin use, 3,500, and 60,000 spent up to a week in hospitals for heroin-caused diseases. That is to say, the leading scientific journal doesn't even check the statistics that come out from the National Institute of Drug Abuse or from the White House on the health effects of heroin use. They're totally unaware of it.
Drug abusers, who some of them live under persistent stress, or they get dirty street drugs, and which immediately would damage the liver or destroy the liver, so they have hepatitis as well, the drug abusers. Yeah? We don't need viruses to explain hepatitis inflammation. You know, alcohol, poisons, yeah? And wrong malnutrition, you know, everything is causing the liver to suffer. When people have a history of hepatitis, most likely they are positive in the HIV antibody test, or put it other way around. I never found a person testing positive who had no problems with its liver. because the liver has a lot of regenerative power, means a lot of decay of cells when being absolutely intoxified, but that means a lot of cells inside your body. And if immune functions are suppressed, then antibodies are produced against your own proteins.
We knew that hemophilias were getting more and more infectious, more and more tumors in the late 70s, early 70s until the early 80s. So we knew that something was going on in hemophilias. So the question in hemophilia was, what is causing this immune deficiency in hemophiliacs? And I think what was causing the new things in hemophiliacs were the way we were treating them.
All of them had hepatitis. That means the inflammation of the liver. And they have such a lot of problems because it was a big business selling clothing factors every day. But this destroyed the hemophiliacs. This caused harm to them to great extent. And when AIDS came up, it was an ideal thing to wash their hands and blame it on a new virus which has been transmitted. What they have overseen, and that's a real catastrophe for all chronic disease, where the energy is produced inside our cells. These bacteria are so stable, integrated inside the cell, that a great deal of their own genetic material has been exported inside the nucleus, where there is protection of the genetic material, better than in the bacteria themselves, but they have their own genetic material. That has been overseen. And now think about the antibiotics killing bacteria. They are killing our own energy plants inside the cell. And if the cell is not able to produce enough energy, it might die. So you go into persistent inflammatory conditions if the body has enough regeneration power to build up new cells, or the cell becomes cancerous using fermentation as its source of energy. And in the liver cells, we have most of the mitochondria present, 500 per cell. So that's the highest concentration of mitochondria. Of course, in egg cells of the women, we have 500,000. And therefore, AIDS is of greatest importance for women due to completely different reason, because with every shot, with unnecessary shot of antibiotica, they would destroy their genetic material, which they would pass over to the offspring. Because the mitochondria are only given to the next generation through the egg cell.
We have to switch our thinking from antibiosis, which means if you are hurt by a microbe, kill the microbe, and many times kill the patient too. But we have to go back to symbiosis from antibiosis, to live in peace with our microbes.
If you think about time in terms of evolutionary time, and you see the population of humans growing like it has, the chances of you getting a human virus today are a hell of a lot higher than they were, say, 10,000 years ago. And it goes up in a funny way. Let's just say that there are an infinite number of retroviruses in the world, because they're changing so fast you couldn't really count them. And as more and more people are in your life, you get more and more chances of getting retroviruses. Now, they all might be harmless. The chances are good that they are, because they're just barely alive. But if you hang out with 1,000 people a year in a way that would maybe allow you to get some or most of their retroviruses, and they hang out with 1,000 people a year, and they hang out with 1,000 people a year, you're hanging out with a fourth of the human race. You're getting all the retroviruses from all over the planet. Now, it might be that none of those things by themselves is going to hurt you, but we know that some of them do grow in your immune cells, right? And they come in at very low multiplicity. You don't make an immune response every time you get a retrovirus inside of you somewhere. But if you have a cell in your immune system that has a retrovirus in it, and you promote that to clonality because it's going to be a part of an immune response, that cell, then the retrovirus will definitely escape. It will flower, in a sense, and it will then have to be dealt with by the immune system, because there'll be enough of it showing in the blood that the immune system will go for it. Well, now, if you've got enough harmless but different retroviruses in your immune cells, such that every time you mount a new immune response, which means you probably take about 500 different immune cells and make 1,000,000 copies out of each one of them, if you've got enough retroviruses in your immune system such that one of those 500 is going to have a retrovirus in it that you've never made an immune response to before, you're going to have to make an immune response to it this time, because it will, if you make a million copies of the cell, it's sure, the retrovirus is certain to flower, to like make infectious bodies, right? Then you have to make another immune response, right? It's called a chain reaction.
Professor Alfred Hassig, one of the world's leading authorities on depression of the immune system and stress relation to that, has put forth within his scientific writings that stress of all forms breaks down the body's capacity to defend its immune system, overwhelms it with stress-related hormones, and that over a period of time, including the verdict that you have been diagnosed with AIDS, that would precipitate a 24-hour negative hormone cascade. Taken into that, you're an already weakened immune system is enough to cause many of the conditions that we're now calling AIDS.
Persistent stress influences diminish the cellular immunity, the lymphocyte immunity, the thymus immunity, and increase the activity of the humoral immunity, the release of antibodies. So the main item in AIDS, in its pathogenesis, is a persistent stress activation of the metabolism.
It has been known already in the mid-70s by Anthony Fauci, by the way. They knew when stress hormones are released, the immune functions are immediately suppressed, because when we are under stress and we have to run away because the lion is behind us, we need no immune functions and waste energy for the replication of immune cells. But the dangerous thing is when we have persistent stress, heavy stress, not like outside the streets, but heavy stress, right? Be it nutritional, be it toxic, be it traumatic, psychological or infectious stress. If this stress is persistent, your body produces a lot of stress hormones, adrenaline, noradrenaline, and they would activate, they stimulate growth. But this is very dangerous, when this persists. So the body wisely makes a reaction against this activation processes, and that's cortisol. And cortisol suppresses every replication of proteins, and therefore as well the replication of cells. So if you are in a state of persistent stress, you are in the same time in a state of persistent hypercortisolism, a huge amount of cortisolism, and then you become thinner and thinner, and your regeneration won't work, and you become more and more positive, means more and more antibodies. But the most important immune functions are not to take care about foreign or not foreign invaders. This is to recycle your own body. 1% of your body mass, and this is an incredible high number, 10 high to the 12 cells, have to be recycled every day. And if this is not possible anymore, then you are in a very bad condition, because your body's own proteins are going to endanger your own life, because they are poisonous if they are freely floating around inside your body, and fungal infections may grow on them.
Our theory predicted that AIDS patients or AIDS can be treated and prevented by antioxidants, and this has been proven by researchers from Stanford University, where they have shown that AIDS patients, including the T4 lymphocytes of AIDS patients, are oxidized, and that oxidation is directly related to the development of AIDS. And conversely, if you give antioxidants to the AIDS patient, the progression of the disease is inhibited.
There is a paradox. In America, we're told that it's the fast-tracked gay and the intravenous drug user most susceptible to developing AIDS. In Africa, we're told that it is the heterosexual that is most susceptible to developing AIDS. Why the contradiction? Well, we haven't looked carefully at the facts. We've been told numbers ranging from 5 million to 25 million Africans have HIV, and that there's going to be an enormous amount of death. But when you actually go to Africa and you interview the physicians working there, you find that these are presumptive diagnoses.
One of the things that is important to emphasize from the outset is that the definition of an AIDS case on the African continent differs decisively from what constitutes an AIDS case, say, in North America or Western Europe. A definition was arrived at as a result of a World Health Organization-sponsored conference in October of 1985. What resulted was what's known as the Bangui definition. The Bangui definition of an AIDS case in Africa is based on four clinical symptoms. The clinical symptoms are a high fever, a persistent cough, loose stools for 30 days, and a 10% loss of body weight over a two-month period. By that definition, a Western researcher like myself has had AIDS. But having gotten on a plane and flown back to California, I'm not considered, of course, an AIDS case. So I think it's important to keep that in mind whenever one looks at the data, the epidemiological data, about what exactly we're counting when it comes to AIDS in Africa.
And tuberculosis is, you know, for all intents and purposes, the AIDS disease in Africa is tuberculosis. So what the HIV theory of AIDS is actually asking us to accept is that sometime in the early 1980s, all the traditional causes of these diseases, especially the infectious diseases, the dysenteries, the malarias, the tuberculosis, which are, let's face it, a symptom of poverty, of poor sanitation, lack of immunisation, lack of medical services, hunger, starvation, were in fact replaced by HIV as the cause of all these diseases. I mean, this is not, to our view, this is not a likely scenario.
Where there have been good research reports, it's clear that these HIV tests render a ludicrously high rate of false positives when those tests are done among populations that already suffer from other kinds of endemic diseases, parasitic infections, and malnutrition. There was a study in the Journal of Infectious Diseases in 1994, for example, that made it quite clear that when they did these HIV tests on a population in Zaire, where there was widespread tuberculosis and leprosy, that the test results in 70% of the cases were false positive. If the test results are 2 or 3% false positive, a test is basically invalid. It's useless in terms of epidemiology. Now, what exactly they would be testing positive for is another question entirely. However, the numbers of AIDS cases are run together with projections of HIV seroprevalence or HIV infection. Usually these tests are conducted at a sexually transmitted disease clinic. Maybe 100 or 200 people are tested, or they're done at an antenatal clinic where pregnant women are also tested. And from those samples, then projections are made about the rate of HIV and the rate of HIV/AIDS, which are run together customarily in Africa. Not only HIV/AIDS for an entire country, but projections can be made, as they were made at the AIDS conference in Geneva in 1998, projections can then be made for an entire continent of 650 million people.
All over the world, entire nations are claiming that we also have an epidemic of AIDS. In India, especially in Bombay and Calcutta, in Thailand, in China, in Haiti, Guatemala, Brazil. Therefore, the idea of giving medications to everyone in a country doesn't seem reasonable. What would seem more reasonable is to give these people the type of infrastructure of clean water, proper medicines, good healthy diet, and de-stressing them from the political conflicts and gross poverty so that they have some optimism and a built immune system to look forward to a future. That is not being done.
What they're finding
is the polyspecific antibodies that are normally in people in Asia and Africa because of the social conditions there. So they have been exposed to many parasites, so they have to have a lot of polyspecific antibodies in the blood, and that's what they are measuring in the ELISA and Western blood tests.
These are the classic symptoms of urban crowding, of poverty, of malnutrition, and of underdevelopment, which in fact afflict men and women fairly equally across the African continent. However, the value of Africa and this notion about a heterosexual epidemic of AIDS in Africa, I think, was extremely important by the middle of the 1980s, because it helped to shift the focus and helped to shift media interest to suggest that, well, while AIDS cases initially may have been confined to a small cohort of urban gay men in the West, that what was going on in Africa was a hint of things to come, in which, in fact, AIDS would put everyone at risk, and it would, in fact, become a heterosexually spread disease.
We had the honor of meeting many African doctors who seriously were worried that the whole of the AIDS science was wrong, and they were not afraid to speak out. But it was very dangerous for them to do so. And they were certainly not going to receive any funding. Because in Uganda, for example, there was $6 million arriving that year for sex counseling and condom distribution. And for malaria control, there were $65,000. So that's for a whole year.
Once the notion got started that stopping AIDS in Africa, which was assumed to be a heterosexually transmitted set of diseases, it could be prevented or stopped by safe sex, then I think early on in the going, there was a considerable interest on the part of missionary and church-related aid groups who argued very strongly that monogamy and abstinence and safe sex were ways, in fact, to prevent this particular kind of disease. To that extent, the WHO and the UN has found it very expedient and very practical along political and ideological lines to argue that the causes of these diseases in Africa and the cure for those diseases lies in the hands of the people themselves, rather than looking at the harder nut, the tougher nut to crack, which would be the historical and the institutional forces that make it such in Africa that many people do not have an adequate diet, few people have adequate sanitation throughout their lives, and the vast majority of people in Africa are subject to a wide range of diseases, all of which predated that of AIDS. So I think that's been a major motivating factor. You have to also understand that there's a reason on the African side to buy into this particular equation. With the end of the Cold War, Africa has found itself unable to play the superpower game, playing the United States or the Western powers off of the Soviet bloc. And so many ministries of health and many governments in general accepted that little dogma, or not get the kind of aid and the kind of assistance that the US government, the United Nations, the World Health Organization, and so forth, felt very strongly that this is what these African governments needed.
In early 2000, South African President Mbeki decided to host an AIDS conference that would give time not only to recognized orthodox spokespersons on AIDS, but to dissenters such as Dr. Peter Duisberg. The mass media fired off numerous attacks, excoriating the irresponsibility of them allowing a forum in South Africa for the people who challenge HIV equals AIDS equals death. Members of the AIDS establishment even went to the length of earnestly calling for the criminal prosecution of AIDS dissidents.
When HIV positive people, children as well as adults, were given effective treatment for the conditions that they actually presented with, which were things like TB, gastrointestinal infections, when they were treated for these conditions, they actually had a better life expectancy than non-HIV positive people within the cohort studied. It was because in the circumstances of these studies, they had undertaken to give medical support to people who tested positive. It was a condition on which the people allowed themselves to be tested. So given that medical support, these people had better health records than those who had not tested HIV positive.
I think this drumbeat of hysteria, of panic, of alarmism, and of fear is doing immense psychological, social, and medical damage to many people in Africa. People who otherwise would have gone to a clinic to get treated for something like diarrhea or a persistent cough or a fever are terrified of going to a clinic because instead of being treated for those kinds of symptoms, they're afraid that they're going to get an AIDS diagnosis, which they understand to be a death sentence. When people do get just such a diagnosis based on those clinical symptoms and they return to their villages, they return to the villages to die. They basically give up all hope. They lose the will to live. They become an outcast. They are in a culture like many African cultures in Southern Africa, where the extended family is everything. To be rejected by your extended family, to be forced to live in a secluded, segregated little hut away from the rest of the family, to have only meager amounts of food, meager amounts of water given to you, is to prepare the person for death. And what do you think happens? The person dies. And when the person dies, they will say, weepingly, with atrocious photographs in the newspaper, he or she was another victim of the AIDS epidemic, which is everywhere in Africa.
If someone came along and told them there is no AIDS, all there is the same diseases that Africans have been dying of all along, then all of a sudden millions of dollars of funding would dry up. And Africans are colluding with this as well. Not very many of them, but there are a few Africans in positions where they're able to collect a lot of this money. You know, heads of clinics or directors of public health services and people like that. There's an awful lot of money that can come their way as long as everybody thinks that Africa is besieged with a giant AIDS epidemic.
The pharmaceutical giants like Roche and Abbott and GlaxoSmithKline and so forth have made offers to African governments, in which I think they expect to be subsidized for this. They've made offers to African governments over the last couple of years, particularly to South Africa, to offer the so-called antiretrovirals, which are a controversy in and of themselves, like AZT and the other nucleoside analog drugs, but to make those drugs available at what the pharmaceuticals would consider a cut rate price. What they mean by cut rate would be that an individual's dose would cost about $200 a month. Well, the vast majority of people in Africa don't have a per capita income of $200 a year. So someone is going to have to subsidize these kinds of drugs, making them available in Africa. And I think that the pharmaceuticals will look towards state organizations or multilateral institutions.
Here it is, all these years later, and it baffles me that not only is AZT still being used, but they're trying to expand its usage into the third world and into Africa, into poor countries, into poor communities in the United States, in spite of widespread evidence of its toxicity, widespread evidence that AZT, in fact, causes what we call AIDS.
They're taking the show to the third world, and they're not only giving AZT to what will probably be millions of women in the third world, whether they're HIV positive or not, but they're also insisting that they stop breastfeeding and start formula feeding, supposedly in an effort to prevent transmission of HIV, which of course has never been isolated from breast milk. Only antibodies, and even that only 25% or something, pretty much like the semen data. But they are, they're launching here what is bound to be a real disaster, a real serious loss of human life.
Mother's milk, which pediatricians around the world will tell you is the healthiest food that a newborn can have because of the immunological properties in mother's milk, that women should in fact cease breastfeeding their young. Now this to me seems something more than just a crime. This is absolutely diabolical and evil, and I am at least encouraged that there's been some dissension and some skepticism for a change within the bowels of the WHO, an organization that's argued very strongly for breastfeeding, is now coming to grips with maybe one of the big contradictions in the whole HIV/AIDS construct.
I can't imagine that it'll work out any other way than that you're going to just see tens, maybe hundreds of thousands, maybe even more babies dying. And they'll probably say they died of AIDS no matter what happens. So nobody will even be held accountable this time. Oh, here's the one thing they're doing. So they can demonstrate that, that this has nothing to do with any particular formula company making money off of this situation. The WHO or UNAIDS or whoever it is insisting that the formula gets shipped in bottles without labels.
For more than a dozen years, virtually every month, magazines would headline amazing new promising drugs in the war on AIDS, the antiretrovirals. The trouble is, when we look back, they didn't work. Lives had not been saved. They were not miracle breakthroughs.
Gallo lost the rights to the test. This was published in Newsweek in 1994. And the American government let him fall like a hot potato. And already the industry built up a new man. This was David Ho here from New York. And he came up with a completely new model of the virus, saying now we have not a slow virus, but we have a virus à grande vitesse, at high speed. And he was using Kermale's PCR technique, which is a multiplication technique, not a quantification technique, by the way, and multiplying molecules into its millions and equal those molecules with the virus, right? Absolutely ridiculous. Even more, as those sequences he's going to multiply and equal them with the virus, that's the viral load, are present in everybody. It's just a way to save face for the whole AIDS industry, because more and more people are aware that this could not be, you know, because inside the AIDS scene there are a lot of critical medical doctors, but they saw such a lot of contradiction, and it was discussed on conferences. So there was high noon for a new metal and a new test where the pharmaceutical companies could make a great business out of it, you know.
All of this stuff is pure Orwellian deception. It has nothing to do with human beings. It's all a creature of the laboratory. The pictures of HIV, the very few examples of electron microscope pictures of HIV, were actually examples of culturing. They were created in the laboratory. There's no published picture of HIV from a human sample, from a blood sample, a tissue sample. You can't find HIV in humans.
I don't know if anybody really knows what the viral load test is finding, but if you're infected with other different viruses, for instance, if you're sick with a cold or the flu or hepatitis or anything, you shouldn't get an HIV viral load test because it's bound to be really high. Now that doesn't seem to make any sense. If what you're measuring is HIV, then why would being sick with something else cause your HIV viral load to go up, unless what they're really measuring is something else?
When I hear constantly AIDS research labs referring to the measuring of viral load, I cannot imagine. To me, it defies common sense to speak about viral load without seeing virus particles. And I've never seen any demonstration of virus particles in what is regarded to be a sample in which viral load, so-called, is being measured by PCR methodology.
Even the manufacturer on the front page, the third paragraph of the instructions, say do not use the viral load test to diagnose either AIDS or HIV. And there's a very simple reason for that. It's because they don't know what it's measuring. The PCR viral load test at best is looking at 3% of the genome of HIV. It's essentially looking at viral debris. The viral load test is equivalent to counting bumpers in a junkyard and assuming that 2,000 bumpers is equivalent to 1,000 cars that you could put the key in ignition and drive off the lot. It's just totally bogus.
Because there are so many such large variation between the HIV genomes, that is between one RNA which is said to be HIV and another piece of RNA which is said to be also HIV genome, the HIV genomes have been divided in many types. If all these are RNAs of a retrovirus, HIV, and if all the tests, the three tests, were measuring the viral load, then one would have expected all these numbers to be exactly the same. And yet, as you can see, one can have from no virus detected, no viral load at all, to up to a million just by using different types of HIV. The same thing, by using different tests, you can have from nearly no virus detected to a very, very high viral load. So one can find really hard to believe that such tests can be used to measure anything, not to mention a deadly virus.
Viral load, they measure small fragments of RNA, and these are body's own cellular debris in this normal cell turnover. Every day a billion cells. But you don't detect in this technology a virus. That's not possible.
I have asked several of the proponents, the major proponents of the HIV hypothesis, Tom Merrigan at Stanford, Martin Markowitz, who works with David Ho at the Aaron Diamond, John Mellers at Pittsburgh. I've asked them, what does the viral load test have to do with infectious virus? Within a heartbeat, the answer is nothing. And the reason they have to say the viral load test has nothing to do with infectious virus is because that's what their own papers say themselves. David Ho's papers in 1996, for example, Piatek's paper in 1993, and all of the other papers. The viral load test has nothing to do with infectious virus, and yet infectious virus is the only virus that causes disease.
The RNA of one HIV with another HIV, whatever that is, it can vary up to 40%. And they're still called HIV RNA. They're still called HIV, which is a little bit hard to accept. It's strange, to say the least.
The miraculous protease inhibitor cocktails are a direct result of David Ho's work that he published in the scientific journal called Nature back in 1995. In that journal, David Ho presented his viral dynamics hypothesis, where he showed that patients that were taking the protease inhibitors, they had substantially reduced viral load numbers, for whatever that means. And it turns out that that paper in 1995 was the principal justification that the FDA used to release the protease inhibitors next year in 1996 for general use among the American public.
They say, the protein of the virus, it's the first protein, it's very long, and it has to be cut down exactly into its pieces that the new virus is able to be built out of the shorter pieces. And now it starts to get funny. We have eight different kind of cutting sites where the protease, the enzyme which is cutting down the proteins, should exactly cut the precursor molecule into its shorter molecules. Eight different sites. Because when they invented the HIV sequence, saying that's the genetic material of HIV, they couldn't think about such details at this time, and now they have the problem to explain it. And they explain it in a way saying, the protease of HIV is unspecific. But how should this work when the protease is unspecific? How then a virus could come into existence when you have eight different sites and it needs to be cut at exactly at those sites to to build up the functional virus particle. And if you have 8 sites and the protease is not specific, you mustn't be a mathematician to say that's absolutely impossible that only a single virus could come into existence. And even worse, now they say the protease of HIV, that's unspecific. But our protease inhibitors, they are specific.
These inhibitors do not stop AIDS patients from dying. They do not stop AIDS patients from getting opportunistic infections. In fact, these inhibitors cause more problems than they solve. They cause AIDS-defining diseases. Anthony Fauci has acknowledged publicly in the front page of the New York Times that the protease inhibitors are likely to fail 50% of the time. In the San Francisco Examiner, University of California San Francisco study showed that 53% of the people taking the HIV protease inhibitors were failing. And they went even further. The people, in their words, that needed the protease inhibitors the most were the ones that were failing. They were the ones that had AIDS-defining diseases. They were the ones that had a history of antiretroviral AZT use. The ones that were benefiting on the protease inhibitors were those who were newly infected. In other words, they had no symptoms. They had no history of AZT use. So when you look at it that way, the HIV protease inhibitors are likely failing 100% of the time.
So the people are still dying. They are not recovering, maybe just for a short time. And the better outcome of the treatment at the moment is the thing that the combination therapy is not as toxic as the 1500 milligram ACT treatment we started. It was much too much.
There's no empirical evidence that people in this category, here we're speaking about asymptomatic people, people who have no complaints or people who are in relatively good health, benefit at all from these drugs. They may or they may not. The studies are not going to be done probably because I suppose the big push is to get everybody who's seropositive for HIV onto treatment. That seems to be the sort of major thrust. In such instances, it may well be that the drugs, the net effect of being on these drugs is going to outweigh any possible benefit, and in that people will do worse.
AIDS in the 1980s was primarily the result of the recreational drug epidemic in the U.S. and in Europe. However, it shifted considerably in the 1990s. In the 1990s, at least half of all new AIDS cases, maybe even 60% now, are a direct result of the antiretroviral therapies themselves.
The chain terminators specifically were used since 1987, when AIDS was on the increase. So AIDS has continued to increase with antiviral drugs of the DNA chain terminator variety, and has decreased when recreational drug use decreased, and continued to decrease when the protease inhibitors were introduced in 97 because recreational drug use continued to decrease. But it didn't decrease as fast, and guess why not? Well, because people who are HIV positive are now being intoxicated, rendered AIDS patients by anti-HIV drugs, which have virtually the same spectrum of diseases that they cause as so-called AIDS is.
In 1998, a group of researchers at University of California at Berkeley and the University of California at San Francisco joined forces to test David Ho's viral dynamics hypothesis. And in short, their results are that Ho's hypothesis is wrong. Their data actually shows that HART, which is short for the highly active antiretroviral therapy, which is simply the protease inhibitor cocktails, that HART actually does what HIV is supposed to be doing. It produces a shorter lifetime for the T cells in HIV positive people taking the drugs as compared with HIV people who do not take the drugs.
So you interfere on a very basic level of life, and it takes a time that you see the clinical outcome of these damages. And it's worse than AZT. AZT acts quicker on the genetic level, but we have the possibility that the bacteria inside our intestines are eating up all this AZT. If you have a good digestion, you know, then that's no problem. But the protease inhibitors cannot be cut down because they are artificial. Then they would accumulate over the time inside your body, producing crystallines, destroying the kidney in the first line and other organs. But then, when they accumulate, would cause the all virus kind of effects. And this we have predicted some 2.5 years before already in the British journal Continuum. We have warned about not the side effects, but the main effects, you know. And the worst to come, it's the failure of the liver. And of course, the blood production, when blood is destroyed, and that's what they say is the side effects, or you know, when the fatty acid metabolism is destroyed as well, and you have fatty acid accumulation everywhere inside your body, you know.
They cause what's called Crixivan belly or Crix belly. They cause the buffalo hump. They cause diabetes. They cause numerous things, opportunistic infections. There's almost one or two new diseases that the protease inhibitors are causing on a weekly basis. All you have to do is go to the British journal Lancet, and you'll see a horror story over the past year of all the toxic effects of these protease inhibitor cocktails.
Protease inhibitors, the principle to inhibit in a stress situation proteolytic activities is in principle correct. But it should not be done with a single substance, with a single drug. It should be done by nutritional supplements, which have an anabolic activity and correct a catabolic situation. These individuals are all in an increased catabolic situation, what means more energy is used than produced.
On one level, if you take a sort of social construction view of the phenomenon of HIV and AIDS, we were maybe in part, you know, producing what we thought we were preventing, in a sense. We were doom-laden, we weren't offering, you know, all-out care to people, in a sense. I think we took quite a conservative view that people infected would develop opportunistic infections and would eventually die.
If we're mistaken, at least we haven't done very much harm. Our theory demands that that safe sexual practices are adopted. Not only that people don't share needles, but people don't take drugs at all. So, I mean, we are in complete agreement in a public health point of view with the HIV theorists. Perhaps we've done some good. Maybe we've stopped a few people worrying about their HIV antibodies. Maybe we've stopped a few people taking drugs to kill a virus that they may not have, that may not even exist. But if the HIV theorists are wrong, who can tell how much harm they have done?
AIDS is not even a medical problem. It's a social problem. And as a social problem, solutions need to be in the social realm, not so much even in the medical realm.
It is not possible in one program to cover all the important issues on a subject as demanding as AIDS. But at least if you now have some questions that you did not have before, if you're not as certain in HIV being the only cause of AIDS, the HIV antibody test being accurate, that the antiretroviral drugs are the way to go, that the vaccine is the miracle cure for the future. If any of this has caused you to pause, then this program has served its purpose. I'm Gary Knoll. Thank you very much for watching.